To continue where we left off yesterday, we were discussing ways of subtracting out the differential reference from the differential input before you put it into a contraption which can tell you whether differential input is greater than 0 or less than 0. We said that we can combine this offset correction as well as reference storage in one operation. And the single-ended equivalent of that thing is shown here. So this is at phi a z bar v in. As we saw yesterday, the capacitor stores not only the reference but also the offset of the preamplifier. Then we said this is supposed to produce during phi a z bar. So what is the output of the preamplifier? Minus a times v in minus v ref. It is v in minus v ref. If I interchange the roles of V in and V ref, I should get, if I just replace V ref and V in, then I will get both of these seem to be reasonable solutions, okay, at first sight. So, can you comment on or the relative merits of potential problem with this is the following, which is, what is the load presented to V in during phi a z? What is it? So, when phi a z is high, what is the situation? It is V in. Capacitance So what is the looking in impedance here? 1 over SC. Okay, why is it 1 over SC? Which voltage is grounded? This voltage is grounded, I agree. Okay, so there is negative feedback around this amplifier. So what happens? This potential, if the negative feedback loop is active with sufficiently large loop gain, in other words the gain is sufficiently large, these two terminals are at the same voltage. So, in principle, this looks like a short circuit. So, the looking in impedance is 1 over SC. So, at the end of the auto zero phase, the voltage stored on the capacitor is simply V in minus V offset. Then, what happens? The first thing is, of course, that if you have 64 comparators, the input capacitance of the whole comparator array will be, for an n bit flash converter, it will be 2 to the power of n minus 1 times C. So the amplifier which is supposed to drive the comparator array will see this capacitance which is almost equal to 2 to the n times. So, can you comment on what you want to make C? Do you want to make C very small or you want to make C very large? If you make C, okay, so we make C small, okay, how small? The smallest value of C I can get is 0, so I'll leave it open. See, if you want to store something on a capacitor, the capacitor can be anything, right? So, what is the bottom line? So, do you want the capacitor C to be large or to be small? When does it discharge? Let's assume that all the switches are ideal and there's no leakage. So, charging action should be faster. What does that mean? Who is supplying charge? V in. Okay. So, clearly if you want the load on the input to be small, you want C to be small. Okay. So, great. So, I will make C go to 0. Is that an acceptable solution? What happens when the input becomes too small? Quantization noise is not KT by C, first of all. The thermal noise is supposed to be much, much smaller than the quantization noise. That's how you will do your design anyway. So, one argument made was, there is going to be some parasitic capacitance at this node. It is true that this node capacitance has to be charged by Vn. But that still doesn't affect the charge on this capacitor, right? I mean, clearly we all agree that from this input capacitance argument, it makes sense as if I would want to make C very, very small, right? But clearly, if I make C 0, then there is no capacitor at all, right? So, somewhere there is something else going on. There is some other thing that one has to consider. So what does that have to do with the capacitor? See, whenever you have switches and capacitors, the first thing you must worry about is charge injection, right? So whenever you open and close switches, charge will get injected on capacitors, right? And the voltage error on a capacitor due to charge injection will be reduced if for the same charge you have a larger capacitance, because the delta V is simply the charge injected divided by C, correct? Alright. So that is telling you that if you make C very, very small, then when you open the switches, the junk that's dumped onto C due to charge injection will basically become a bigger problem. Fine. Okay. What else? So the argument goes like this. You know that in practice the preamplifier will have capacitance of its own, right? Input capacitance between. It's a differential pair, right? So you're looking in between the two terminals, there is gate capacitance, there is some parasitic capacitance Cp, alright. So during phi 2, what happens? This is connected to Vref. The initial charge on this capacitor was, assume the offset is 0, was Vn. So when you take a capacitor which has been initially charged to Vn, okay, and connect it in such a fashion, right, so the initial charge on this capacitor was Vn, yes, C. Then I take this and connect it, Cp is initially uncharged, and I connect this to Vref. What is this voltage? One is nothing but it is Vref, let me call this Vn, it's Vref minus Vn times C by C plus Cp. Okay, one argument is a capacitor divider, so I understand the Vref times C by C plus Cp part, right? Where is this Vn by times C by C plus Cp coming? The initial condition, so you can model a capacitor with an initial condition Vn as an initially uncharged capacitor. In series with the voltage source is Vn, it's in the opposite direction of Vref, so Vref minus Vn times C by C plus Cp. So, what is the bottom line? If C becomes very, very small, what happens? What is the preamplifier amplifying? The preamp's job is to simply take whatever voltage is there between its two terminals and amplify it by gain A, correct? So, because of this parasitic capacitance of the input of the preamp, we see that the output of voltage of the preamplifier is A minus A times C by C plus Cp times Vref minus. Making C too small, okay, while it is attractive as far as driving the input load is concerned, okay, is problematic because one, it reduces the effective gain of the preamplifier, right? And if you reduce the gain of the preamplifier, what happens? Why does it have to bother us? Preamp's job is to reduce the offset of the latch when referred to the input of the preamp, because that offset is getting divided down by the gain of the preamplifier. And now, thanks to this capacitive attenuator, you basically are reducing the gain of the preamplifier. So, if C is too small, two things happen. One is charge injection. Second one is that the preamp gain is reduced. Now, the obvious question is, C too small is no good. Okay, what if I go to the other extreme? If I make C too large, what happens? Both these above problems associated with a small capacitor go away. But you have another set of problems. What are the problems? So increased load capacitance looking into the comparator array. What else you think? If you have bigger capacitors, you need more time to charge if you have the same charging current. Alright, another way of looking at it is if you have a bigger bucket, it takes longer time to fill. If the tap So diameter is the same. If you want to fill it quicker, you have to have a wider tap. That's all. excuse me, what else do you think could be a problem? Okay, one of course is capacitor is big, you need space for it. Another practical thing is the following. Do you know how capacitors, how do you make a capacitor on a chip? There is basically the silicon substrate. You make your transistors on the substrate. Okay, so if you want to make an NMOS transistor, the drain is N plus and so on. If you want to make a PMOS transistor, the substrate is always P-type. You make an N-well and then you make P plus contacts for the source and drain, you grow the gate. But it doesn't help to have just isolated transistors floating around. You need to connect the terminals of one transistor to the terminals of the other. Okay? And this is done by what are called interconnect layers or metallization layers. Right? So what they do is, it's pretty much like a PCB. I don't know how many of you are aware of what the board that you see in your computer, right? And if you didn't know, a typical board that the motherboard in your PC is not just one layer on top and one layer below. It can have as high as 8 or 10 layers, sometimes even more than that. So what they do is they have one layer of epoxy, then they have metal routing, then they pour another layer of epoxy, okay, then another layer of metal and so on, because the number of connections required is so many that with two layers it's just physically impossible to make connection A to connection B. So the whole thing on an IC is just very similar to what happens in a PCB, except that the whole thing is in a miniature scale. So once you do this, pour oxide on top of this and then you will pour metal 1, then you will pour oxide, then you pour metal 2. Depending on what you want to connect to where, you basically have vias which connect from this wire here in metal 1 to the drain. Okay. So if you want to make capacitance, what could you do? Capacitance is nothing but two metal plates in parallel, right? So one idea to capacitors is, choose metal, the first layer of metal, the second layer of metal, the capacitance between them is, you can use it as a capacitor. You can also use the parasitic capacitance of the MOS transistors. For example, let's say I made a capacitor using two parallel metal plates. This could be metal 2 and this could be metal 1. Okay, and this is the substrate. So between these two is my capacitor, correct? But between the lower plate of the capacitor and the substrate, there's always parasitic capacitance. In this particular picture, C parasitic is smaller than the C that you want to build, simply because the distance between the two parallel plates is much smaller than the distance between the bottom plate and ground. The bottom line, therefore, is that every time you put down a capacitor like this and a capacitor in the schematic, one of the plates is associated with a parasitic bottom plate capacitance. Okay, so something like this. And depending on the technology, this could range anywhere from say 5% to 30% of your C. So this is often called the bottom plate capacitance and is associated with the parasitic between the bottom plate of the intended capacitor that you want to make and the substrate. The substrate is always connected to ground. So if I went on increasing this capacitor, what happens now? Now that you know that this bottom plate parasitic increases, so what? So then, now you're faced with a new set of problems, which is, you have the freedom to choose which plate you call what. So, should I put my bottom plate this side? This is the input parasitic capacitance of the preamp itself. This is, I call the bottom plate. Let me make this about 0.1C. So, two questions arise now. Should I make the bottom plate get on to the left? Or should I push it towards the right? Which of these two is a better strategy? Okay, the left is a better strategy. The obvious question is why. So whether you have CX here or here, to the left or the right, the voltage stored on the capacitance C remains the same. However, the attenuation gain of the preamp is now A times C by C plus CP plus CX, whereas the gain here is nothing but A times C by C plus. Gain, when you put the bottom plate towards the right hand side, is definitely smaller. Okay. Then one can argue, but the input impedance looking here, maybe the gain is smaller, but maybe the looking impedance is smaller too. So then may not be too bad an idea. But if CX is small compared to C, if CX is much smaller than C, the looking in impedance in both cases is 1 over S times CX plus CP. Okay? Whether you put the parasitic to the left or the right, the load that the previous amplifier sees, or the input impedance of the complete comparator array, remains the same. By choosing the bottom plate on the right side, you know, you lose the preamplifier gain because of capacitive attenuation. Does make sense? So which is the better strategy? Question now is, do you want to use metal-metal capacitors or do you want to use the gate source capacitance of a MOSFET? Okay. In this particular case, it doesn't matter, right? Because the linearity of this capacitor is not really that big of an issue. But in practice, if you want a linear capacitor, you will want to use metal-metal capacitors. If you don't mind non-linearity, you will use. The distances involved there are much, much smaller than the distances involved here, right? There, the gate oxide thickness is very small. So you get a large density. But the capacitance between the gate and the source and the bulk is also quite large. No, there will be capacitance between the channel and the bulk. But please note that the dielectric constant of silicon is 11.9 or some 12 or something like that, whereas the dielectric constant of oxide is only 4. So even though it's depletion capacitance, the ratio of the parasitic to the main capacitance can be as high as 15 to 20% without any problem. Okay. The bottom plate parasitic is a problem. Therefore, by making the capacitance too large, you will start getting hit by the bottom plate capacitance. So now the question is, what is the sane value to choose? No, I mean, well, if you make the chip big, then you can have as many capacitors as you want, right, in principle. It definitely is limited by the number of metal layers. So you will see that in practice, in modern technology today, reasonable, high density metal capacitors, are in the range of 0.5 to 1 femtofarad per micron square. So this is not too bad, because if CP is like say 5 femtofarads, all that you want to do is make C, much larger than 5 femtofarads. I typically choose, when I am designing, I typically choose a factor of 10. Okay. So if this is 5 femtofarad, I will choose 50. Okay. I mean, it's just, there is nothing holy about the factor of 10. Alright. So you can see that this is about, will be about 40 to 50 micron square, which is about 7 microns on a side. On the other hand, MOSFET gate capacitance can be very, very dense. So today's transistors for example, 90 nanometer technology will probably be around about 12 to 14 femtofarads per micron square. So the density of MOS capacitors is much higher than that of metal capacitors, simply because the gate oxide is much, much thinner than a few tens of angstroms, right? Whereas the separation between metal layers is much larger. So as I said, the reasonable strategy is to choose simply C to be about anywhere between 5 and 10 times. Okay, so getting back to the disadvantages of this character here, during the phase when phi AZ is high, this has been has to drive a really large capacitive load. Okay, what about VREF? What about the load on VREF? During phi AZ bar, what happens? That node is connected from input to reference. Right? So what do you think is the load on the reference on VREF? Infinite. Why? During phi AZ bar equal to 1, the equivalent circuit simply becomes VREF. You have this C which is holding on it Vin, and then you have the CP and the CX, which is the bottom plate capacitance. So the equivalent load on VREF is only CP plus CX, whereas the load on the input is C plus CX times the number of comparators. Now let's come to this one here. The only difference between A and B here is that the positions of Vin and VREF are interchanged. So whatever happened to VREF earlier will happen to Vin now, and vice versa. Okay. So the load on the input is much, much smaller than the load on the VREF. On VREF the load is basically C, and on the input the load is nothing but CP plus CX. From clock cycle to clock cycle, what do you think is constant? Is Vin the remaining the same, or is VREF remaining the same? Yes. VREF is remaining the same. Okay. The voltage. So what is the voltage on this capacitor? Yeah. If V offset is zero, the voltage on this coupling capacitor is simply VREF. So even though it is true that the load on the VREF is large, please note that the capacitor is almost always almost charged to VREF. Okay. Alright, so when you connect a capacitor which is almost charged to VREF back onto a battery of voltage VREF, the battery has to only provide enough current to make up for the difference, correct? Whereas in the other case, in circuit B here, what has happened, the input is dynamically changing, correct? So in one cycle the input might be the maximum, in the other cycle the input might be the minimum. So the input has to not only discharge the previous value, it has to also supply current to make the capacitor output follow the present input. So all this considered, which do you think is a saner choice? Yeah, so this is definitely a better choice than here with regard to the preamp, the issue of timing. After that we will go into some representative preamplifier circuits, and I think that should give you a reasonable flavor of the real comparator.